answer. It's difficult. Again, we're talking about evaluations. How are some of these things actually being evaluated? It's tough. I don't know.
So many researchers actually find the SET is reliable. Again, going back to our scientific definition, it keeps measuring the same thing, but it's not valid. Although some would argue it's both unreliable and invalid. So even positive traits from professors, such as how much output a professor has, how prestigious they are, et cetera, that doesn't get factored into the evaluation. So you can have a professor who wins a Nobel Prize, but the students don't like him, so he'll get low marks. But obviously you're not going to say that person's not good at what they do, so that's misleading as well. And course evaluations do appear to measure how likable and fun a professor is. So, for example, there was a Dr. Fox experiment done in 1973 where they had a good-looking, charismatic, energetic lecturer give a nonsensical lecture on mathematical game theory and its application to physical education. Participants rated the lecture highly. So they've done subsequent findings, similar studies, and they've shown the same things. Professors who tell jokes and are entertaining in other ways receive higher marks than those who don't. Charismatic traits influence scores. Some researchers are even worried that the SET is more like a personality test rather than a serious evaluation. One study asked students to rate the professors on their Big Five personality scores. The Big Five are openness, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. Jordan Peterson talks about these all the time. After only 5 minutes of exposure, they then asked the students to evaluate them in both after week 10 and week 16. They also asked the students to rate the effectiveness in teaching. In the end, there was a very high correlation between the two criteria, resulting in about 64 to 73% correlation. So teachers that had more positive personality traits were also considered more effective teachers. Michael Humer, he's been on Tom Woods and elsewhere. He cited a similar study, which showed a 76 to 84% correlation. And they also showed that apparently the better looking a professor were, they got a 0.8 boost in score. So that's almost a whole additional point just for being good looking. Now, the authors make the point, let's say it's sort of play devil's advocate. You could argue better looking, more charismatic professors may get students to pay better attention. That may translate into better learning. It's possible, but again, it's kind of hard to prove, at least based on this data. So one tried to compare the validity of SETs by comparing the student evaluations to professors rating each other. Also, comparing it to the evaluation the deans gave. They found there was a high correlation, actually, between the deans and the student reviews, but they found that the evaluation compared to the professors was pretty low. And that gets tough too, because again, if professors are friends with each other, if professors don't like each other, it's like, how do professors rate other professors on how well they teach? It's kind of tough, because again, it's like two professors can be friends and they can just give someone a good mark. This professor doesn't like that professor, they may give them a lower mark. They may get along, but they may disagree on how to teach. Some of these things get kind of murky again. So any thoughts or comments on that?
Yeah, no, that goes into something where we were talking about, okay, people say the controlled environment of the school actually helps, and there's things that go into that where many countries have developed a system where the parents rely on schools in part for daycare, and that's just K-12 more so than university level than college and university level. But you have that, and we've mentioned this previously, why are some teachers objecting to the remote learning and things like that? And there could be something like this, where somebody does feel the way they look is going to actually aid them in communicating to the children in person, that if they do it digitally, that won't happen. But then there is an inverse that I heard that I would be remiss not to mention, is they're also talking about the home environments of some people. Now, this is things to take into account, where some anecdotal things or people had seen some rather questionable activities going on in the homes of the kids. And then you have this thing on Zoom, so it's like they could be someone's parent walks by like unclothed in the background, and that's something that would happen in the classroom. But if you're in a Zoom call, like a community Zoom call, then all the other students see that, and there might be added things, or they might be some kind of room that might not added judgmental, where there's enough judgment of like, oh, this person has these kind of shoes, has this person has this kind of what. They might be, oh, look at this person's room, like their shabby room, and then they get made fun of the room. So there's other things to kind of add when you're looking into the actual perception and understanding of learning. Now, I don't know how much that applies and affects in, as I mentioned, when you talk about the higher education we're focusing here versus the K through 12. But yeah, those things. And an extra thing with the looks thing, there is a discrepancy in how female teachers are treated when it comes to sexual relations with their students versus the inverse of that. And that is also highly correlated to the attractiveness of said female teachers. If it's like some 55-year-old married teacher versus some young 20-something-year-old teacher, they'll have a different interaction with that. And now, the same way that you have those biases, you might rate them better, but then it might be better for you to not think what they're saying is correct, and you'd be able to notice more things as a student and actually learn better. Yeah, so there's things to kind of account for here.
And that also is just the male versus female thing, like you're saying with your good-looking female professor. Girls in the class may say, I don't like her, but they're not attracted to her, so they're not going to cloud that judgment. But then the reverse happens too. Oh, you have the hot chef for this class. Okay, they would give that chef a more favorable rating. Whereas to me, it's okay, yeah, it's just some guy. So it's like all again and again, like I'm not knocking. Okay, if you think a person's attractive, fine. But it's like ideally, you're not supposed to be rating them on those things. Like he says, it's become a personality test. And if you're there to get educated, you're not there to be friends. That's the argument that keeps coming up with Trump. It's like even a lot of people who support him are saying like, look, I mean, you know, we're not voting for someone based on personality. He's not my friend. It's how good of a job do they do. That's the criteria. Mm-hmm. It's not like they're not there to be your buddy. That's essentially. Yeah.
And there was one of my early moments also get disillusioned going back to George Bush, where I was like, okay, like I get he doesn't seem that intelligent. He seems to be doing some things that are weird, but he seems like a guy you could just meet at the bar and have a beer with.
Yeah.
And I thought of that and I was like, okay, I can get that's kind of why some people might have voted for him. But then I started getting more and more into politics. And by the time Obama came around, people were saying that same thing about him. Yeah. And I was like, is that really a positive thing? Like,
yeah.
At that time, I was like, okay, now I go to bars more. Yeah. I've seen the bar environment. Would I want the average person I meet at a bar running the country? Right? At that point, I'm like, you guys must be going to much better bars than I'm going to. Yeah. Like, I want the person running the country to be somebody where it's like, that person would not even want to spend a second talking to me because they're at such a higher level, they're doing such more important things that they wouldn't be wasting time at the bar. They'd be doing some other, like, productive stuff. Those are the kind of people. Like, if there actually was a sort of elite, I would want the elites to actually, if they actually would want Illuminati, it's almost like Illuminati actually would be better if there actually was some kind of selected group of people that really was more capable at running stuff when it comes down to it. And we don't really have a system that really organizes for that. Like you could say like monarchies in a way had, like I think even monarchies in a way had more of a system of selecting certain kind of traits in order to be an effective ruler. And that's more due to the fact that you had a system where the person was more invested in the future of this country because their children were going to hire it. And then that self-interest of them looking forward for themselves and their kids over everybody else, the best way to ensure that positive for their future was to make sure the country was as comfortable and peaceful as possible so their kids could inherit that and keep going with that generational wise. Because if you lost that, chances are your family line was dying. You were done. Yeah. You're dead. But at the same point, it might have had a system that was better at selecting for success, for good people at it. But it also had a system that selected that if you got a crap person, it was crap for everyone. And those people were embedded. So right now with the democracy, as they say, it's the best of the possible evils that we have. It might not select for a class that's much better at doing what they're doing, but also create some kind of systems and checks and balances with some term limits in certain parts of it where these people, if they're bad, there's a way to remove that person and you're not just damned with these people for in perpetuity and things like that. So, yeah.
So to sort of add on to your points, I think you're sort of citing Democracy, the God That Failed by Hans Hermann Hoppe. I highly recommend that book to anyone who hasn't read it. He basically makes the argument. Well, he's an anarcho-capitalist. He's not arguing for monarchy, but he's making the point that in the case of monarchy, monarchs were invested in maintaining their kingdom because they're going to pass it on to their kids and then their grandkids, et cetera, whereas these democratically elected politicians, they're milking the cow as much as they can, and then if the problems emerge, oh, well, I'm out of office or dead, I don't really care. So mm-hmm. They're not thinking Obama's not thinking, oh, what's the country going to look like in 50, 100 years? Because, yeah, he'll be gone. So who cares?
Yeah.
And then the other thing I was going to add about bar scenes, I laugh. One of my good friends, Abram, I actually met at a bar, but he's probably like the only one that I've actually had like a long lasting relationship with. We met at the 8th Street Wine Cellar near where I used to work. So occasionally you do. But again, it's like you say, do I want the average person I would sit at the bar with running things based on who I've met? No, probably not.
That is a good point. I used to smoke. Yeah. Definitely used to smoke cigarettes and things like that. And one of my really good friends I actually met because I was in a bar in San Francisco a couple of times, and then you had to smoke outside, so there was like a smoking area, and that person was out there. And then so there are those things. But then again, we're self-selecting. That's why I'm thinking the bars these people must go to are also very self-selecting. Like, I didn't just go to any bar. Like, there was some reason I was at that bar versus the many other bars I could have been at. So I'm thinking for somebody to just use that average person at the bar, because even at that bar itself, I wasn't talking to every single person. These were a select group of people within that bar. So I'm not just like down on bar culture, because a lot of people are great people out there. And there's a lot of people in my life who I value who, if I wasn't at the bar, but you can't really compare that because I can't say like, who would I have met if I was like at the library? Something, but anyway, I've met some good people at bars. So
because again, like with this place, it's a wine bar, so it's a little pricier. So in general, you're going to attract people who are more into that kind of thing. Whereas like, I used to love going to college dive bars when I was like 22 or something. Now I just like, it's a waste of time. Like, I remember I went with Abram and one of our mutual friends. I felt so out of place there. Like, good looking girls and stuff, but I'm like, okay, it's noisy. I have to shout at the person next to me. I'm not going to have meaningful conversations with anyone here. It's like, why am I here? And it was one of those things. We went because our friend wanted to go, and I was like, all right, I'll humor him. But it's like, would I go here on my own? No.
this again repeats the importance in there. And this is the title of this paragraph: on reading entrails. Why do I keep saying entrails? And entrails and student evaluations is what are you selecting for? How many other parts of our life do we select on the way schools are selected, either the school you attend to or the way people are evaluated, the quality of that relationship? There's many other things that I think are far less important than schooling that we hold to much higher standards of selection and confirmation to actually consider something positive or even something to do. You know, like the amount of the research people do just to like order some food versus like pick a university sometimes is an entirely different thing. It's a strange kind of situation. Thank you for listening. This has been a clip from an actual longer recording that I'll try to leave a link to on the screen or somewhere around here where you're listening to this.
Peasants.
Peasants.
Okay.